one is the humanitarian crisis for the ages. And when you look at the figures, they are absolutely staggering. More than 7 million people displaced in Iraq, more than 2 million displaced. Sorry, that was 7 million displaced in Syria, 2 million displaced in Iraq, and millions of people who have urgent needs for food, shelter, everything else. It's not just the numbers. When you go around this country, you see entire communities that have been uprooted. You see families that have been torn apart. When I came to the Kurdistan region last June, I was seeing families living in construction sites who had endured just unspeakable horrors, their family members killed, being captured, surviving attacks. They managed to make their way down Sinjar Mountain into Syria and into a very welcoming Kurdistan region, and they ended up living in construction sites. I went back there 2 weeks ago, and many of them are still living in construction sites. Long before June, there were thousands of families fleeing Anbar who were having trouble even arriving in places like Samarra, let alone being welcomed. This is a crisis of staggering proportions. Syria is shattered, Iraq is fragmenting. We have this wonderful panel here to talk about it. We have with us, first of all, His Excellency, the Governor of Dohuk, perhaps the province that's been most affected by this crisis, Ferhat Atrushi. We have His Excellency, the Governor of Sulaimania, Aso Feridun. And we have Georgi Bustin from the Deputy, I always have trouble with that acronym. He's the Deputy Special Representative for the Secretary General in Iraq, and he's been here for 4 years and knows more than many of us, many of us journalists, certainly. We have Angus McKee, who is the Consul General of the UK to the Kurdistan region and northern Iraq, and has experience in Syria as well. We have with us Dr. Choman Hardy, who is a women's activist, a specialist in the role of women in revolution, an expert in mental health issues, and Deborah Amos, who many of you know from National Public Radio, NPR, who has done more to humanize these humanitarian crises than most people I know.
Thank you.
We're going to start off with 5 minutes each, and I wonder if we could start off with you, Your Excellency. Your province has indeed been the most affected. There are some communities across this region where there are actually more displaced people than residents. One of the things that strikes me about Iraq and the Kurdistan region is the ability of governments and people to very quickly become normalized to a situation that's very abnormal. Is this what it is going to continue to be like here?
Thank you very much, Jane. Spedavosh, Galax Posbo, Recherit, the Forumeus Posbo, the Barhamku, Prostias, Jadwali Donabum. I will try to convey my message in English, if it's possible. Thank you very much. I will focus on 2 points. The first one, I will give you some information and data, and no need to explain about what happened during this 8 months in Mosul province, because for 2 days we are listening to the politicians and leaders what happened exactly. In Dohuk province, we start receiving refugees in 2012, a very big number from Syria, from the western part of Kurdistan. Around 250,000 people came into Dohuk and then spread it to Erbil and Sulaimania. But still the big number, the big bulk of refugees are in Dohuk camps. We have 4 camps for refugees, Dumis 1, Dumis 2, Acre, and Gawilan. And we received lately around 33,000 people from Kobani also. Erbil Governorate helped us in receiving some of these people, and others were left in Dohuk, and I'm sure that some of them came to Sulaimania. This was the first wave. The second wave, or even I can say before that, there were Iraqi IDPs from Mosul, from Fallujah, from Anbar, even from Baghdad. If you remember, during the protest against the previous government in Anbar, many people fled from those areas For example, I have in a very northern district of Ahmadiyya, I'm sure that many of you heard of it, about 1,000 families from Fallujah, which is very strange to have 1,000 families in Ahmadiyya. So that one was the almost the first wave of IDPs coming to Duhok. It's around 160,000 to 170,000 people, but we did not consider them as IDPs because they were living in houses, in apartments, and they were living with their relatives and friends. So, but still they are IDPs for, let's say, 2 or 3 years. The second wave, it was after the collapse of Mosul, or when Mosul was taken by ISIS in 10th of June. Then the second wave came to Duhok from the IDPs. Thousands of families crossed the border between Mosul or Nineveh province to into Duhok. The largest wave was in August, in after the Sinjar and Zumar area were taken by ISIS. We received hundreds of thousands of people from the, these areas, and the majority or most of IDPs in August were Yazidis, and they were the biggest victims. In the second point, I'm going to focus on that one. So the total number, according to our data, maybe some people will say is an exaggeration. It's not, because as I said, we have two groups of IDPs. Some of them are living in camps and unfinished buildings, as you mentioned, and others are living with their friends, relatives, apartments, house, but still they are IDPs, and it's a heavy burden on the Duhok province and KRG in general. Now the total number is around 820,000 refugees and IDPs. We have 20 camps. I have a very good report by the emergency cell in the governorate, which prepares the reports and update it. We have the names of all the camps in a table here, with the number of the families, with the number of the individuals in these camps, the areas, and even a geographic map of camps which we have. As I said, 20 camps, 16 for IDPs, 4 for refugees, and 2 more camps are under construction with the help of the federal government. UN has built, if I'm not mistaken, 7 camps. Around 8,000 units were built, of course, tents, by UN agencies, and around 21,000 units built by us as a governorate with the help of KRG and federal government, and 6,500 units, of course, tents, again, by AFAD, the Turkish agency, which helped us in building 2 camps. So within few weeks we will have 22 camps in Duhok. Some camps we have 5,000 families, in some camps 3,000 families. I would just give an example on electricity. The Department of Electricity in Duhok, they have calculated that the burden on KRG is around $287 million per year on electricity, because we are providing these camps for 24 hours electricity with no money for free. So they take almost 113 megawatts of electricity from our own national electricity network, which is again a burden on the citizens in Duhok and in KRG also. This, as I said, of course we have many issues. The main one is that the UN agencies were helping in the beginning in a very slow manner, and we criticized them. It's our right, but we know that they were also facing many problems. After that, the work was improved, especially by WHO, by WFP, and other agencies. But now we are facing another problem. They are informing us that by March or by April, they are going to be out of fund, and nobody is going to fund the UN agencies in Iraq, because Syria is becoming a priority for the international community, which is, I don't know, but it will be a disaster because food is the first thing which we can serve them. Without food, we cannot save these people, which is very important. The second point, which is I'm going to, in maybe 1 minute, I will focus on it, the social and psychological aspect of this tragedy and humanitarian disaster which happened in Sinjar area. Unfortunately, for 2 days, politics was dominant, and nobody spoke about the humanitarian aspect of the crisis. Many people, innocent people, children, women, became victims of this terrorism, barbaric actions of Daesh in Sinjar. I remember we visited a tent. A guy lost his wife and the 2 daughters were crying every day that where is their mother. So the mother, I asked the father, where is your wife? He said that my wife was taken by ISIS and one of the daughters. So imagine that, what happened to these people. With all my respect to our Arab brothers, our even Christians, but women were not taken from the Arab villages. Yes, they were slaughtered, they were killed, but women's children were not taken by ISIS. Another example, one of our Yazidi brothers told me that the children for 3 months were under Daesh, and they were forced to pray. They forced them to pray. So 8 years, 10 years, boys and girls. So when they were released by Daesh and they came to the camps in Dohuk, they were still praying in every morning, Muslim prayer. So the father and mother were telling them, please don't do that. That one was done by ISIS and they are terrorists. You should not do that. You are from another religion. But the child, he doesn't know anything because he was afraid that somebody will going to put more. The same thing with the changing of names. I mean, many people were, for example, I know an example, somebody called Ayat, his name is Ayat, they changed his name to Muhammad. And even now, when somebody call him Ayat, he doesn't know he means Ayat, the real Ayat. If you call him Muhammad for once, he will just turn around and answer you. If you call him 20 times Ayat, he will not remember that. So imagine what, I mean, these are very small examples of what happened to the Yazidis. Yes, all are victims. We have Shabak, we have Kakei, we have many Arabs, I said. We have many Christians who are not going to the camps. And we have hundreds of thousands of Yazidis who are mainly in camps because they are coming from a very poor background, economic background, social and educational background. Governor, so it's a disaster. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, and we hope to get into those issues during the questions as well. Governor Asso, Sulaimani has perhaps not had the same number of displaced people, but you certainly have taken in people from Kirkuk, and with the coming offensive in Mosul, it seems there could be even more. Are you preparing for an influx of displaced?
پیششی بانی هم ولایتان باش و خیر بین بو سلیمانی پایتخت روشنبیری حکومت هریمی کردستان بخیر بین و هیوادارم کاتی کی بسود کاتی کی بنرخو خوشتان لگل برنامه منتدا کتان بر بیت سر سپاسی همو او خیون کارو ما مستا و همو او کسانی که بشدار بوندا رخصتنيم ملتقايا سيداتي سادتي الأعزاء ضيوفنا الكرام مرحبا بكم في السليمانية العاصمة الثقافية لحكومة إقليم كردستان أتمنى أن تقضوا وقتا ممتعا ومفيدا مع برنامج هذا الملتقى وأشكر كل الأساتذة والطلاب القائمين عليه. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the capital of culture, to Sulaimani. I hope you are spending a useful and a good time with the programs of the University of American University, and I would like to thank everyone who actually helped in arranging this. I will go to my laptop to, because I have got a presentation to tell you about the realities in Sulaimania. What my objective is, as I will going to speak in English, my objective is to say that Sulaimani has also got a huge problem facing all the increasing numbers of IDPs and refugees coming to Syria. I will try also to say what the current situation is. I will try to tell you what is the reality, what we are doing, and what we are planning to do in the future. Okay, so the first time we received refugee, and I should say here, this is the first time for Kurdish people as a government to experience managing refugees on their land. We used to be refugees ourselves. The Turkish government and the Iranian government have good experience in managing, but we haven't had this experience before. So it's a challenge for the Kurdish government to manage these large numbers of refugees and IDP. The refugees started in 2011, but the influx was actually in August 2013. And then that was when the large numbers of Syrian people moved into Sulaimaniyah. Instantly, the government moved people into mosques and schools, 8 to 9 of them, then into a transient camps. The number of refugees in Sulaimaniyah is 23,000 people, and that usually comes from Syria and from the Kurdish territory of Syria, Qamishlu, Hasaka, and Kobani. The families are 10,161. So they moved into, so what we did, we moved them into a transient camp initially. Then by June 2014, it was the first camp in Sulaimani in Arbat, or we called them Barika. This is the camp. This is what we're doing as electricity-wise, and this is the camps. It hosts 10,000 people, 2,000 families, 8 blocks. Only 5 of them has finished so far. And most of these people living there are refugees from Syria, as I said, Qamishlu, Hasaka, and Kobani. We are waiting to finish the other 3 blocks and then moving more people into there. They have, if the people, then we have people. This is the problem. We don't have enough camps. I will come to the fact of what is the plan. We have many refugees and IDPs scattered in the city, scattered around Sulaimani, scattered in Germian, scattered in Kanakawa, Tasluja, Pira Magrun, and other places. The refugees have the privilege of they came in earlier, and therefore they have an access to education, they have an access to the health system, they have a residency or permit to work in Kurdistan region. I will move now to the IDP. This is where the problem is, the number of them, and the way the influx start. Okay, well, we have an IDPs since 2006 and 7. Let's be practical about it. I have many friends of mine, graduated from the College of Medicine, doctors, who started to flee Iraq, flee Baghdad, flee Diyala, and we have engineers, doctors, who are now working in Kurdistan. They are in the hospitals, they are in the market, they are in the companies. That was individuals. The influx actually started in 2000 and with ISIS last year. That was the problem. I remember just 6 weeks after I was appointed as a governor of Sulaimani, I had a call from this gentleman sitting here who has got an excellent role in helping us, Colonel Hassan, and we have the government emergency cell saying that we have 600 families in a very cold day in the border in Chamchamal just arrived there with many children facing death. So we had to move them so quickly to Sili, keep them in Bakhtiari, in one of the mosques, and then move them into the transient camps. The number of the IDPs by the 28th of August is 290,000 people. That's a 48,000 families. Adding the two numbers together, that is about 315,000 people. This is the camp. This is the transient camp in Arbat. And you might ask why we're not doing the road and why is it still mud? Unfortunately, this is a private land. But fortunately, on the other hand, we now started, with the help of the UNHCR, to build another camp of for 1,048 families for IDPs, which is owned by the government. It's a 25,000 meter square, as similar to this. This holds 17,000 people, or 2,000 families. The capacity of this is around 1,000, to be honest. So this is very hard. I should here thank the Minister of Migration of his great help for the regional government. The only things I cheated on him, I took him in a very cold day. It was raining and snowing. I had my boot. He didn't have anything. This is our visit to the camp. The camp that I should say here mainly are hosted or occupied by, number one, Yazidi, about 300 families, Shabak from Mosul, and mainly the Arab Sunnis from Yathrib, Salahuddin. again, some just children's, very bad situation in there, very bad.
I'm afraid we're almost out of time.
I've got 1 minute, one more minute. Okay, I'm going to talk about two things in these camps. Okay, we have two problems then. We have large number, only few camps. I'm going to tell you about the future plans for the camps. But the main two issues, health. Okay, there's no support. And that's why I was trying. The Ministry of Migration is really doing very well, really helping. We need a better liaison with the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Education down in and that's a call for the government who are here. Seven schools will be built up. The IDPs outside the camp, I should be honest, they have no opportunities for education, lack of Arabic school. We are now building about seven schools in different parts of Sulaimania so they can accommodate those IDPs. One more, and this is the last slide, but just to show you how difficult it is. Health, 25,000 consultation, 25,000 people went to the consultation to the outpatient clinics in Sulaimania. Out of them, 6,000, 30,920 are from IDPs and refugees. 11% of the medical consultation is actually done by the refugees and the IDP. Not just that, even birth, 16% of birth in the main hospital here in Sulaimania is actually people from refugees and IDPs. The future plan is we have a camp we'll take 1,048 on 102 donum or 25,000 meters square in Arbat. We have a quarter to Antaza there by the MODM, by the Ministry of Migration. Barzinja by the UN Habitat, only 152. And then we have Zirguez and Sitek taking 162 Christian IDP currently. And then we have a plan for Sirdash for 850. This is Ashti. This is Qora 2, this is a UNHCR IDP, almost done. We will open this by the end of this month. This is the central project, so the MODM project, cabinet. This will finish on the 15th of March. So, and this is the whole thing, it's a 1,000 cabinet with everything, electricity, water, and everything else. Thank you for your help. What I'm trying is, I hope that alongside the discussion, we can talk a bit about how all of you can help us in helping refugees in IDP. Thank you.
That would be great. Thank you so much. Georgi, it's clear that the scale of the nature of this conflict and this crisis has overwhelmed the entire UN system, as well as aid agencies and governments. Can you tell us if there are any lessons learned from this by the UN?
Thank you so much. Actually, I was going to begin with thanking our gracious host, Barham Saleh, for making this possible. And now, this is not the empty politeness. The UN is hugely grateful to have this opportunity. On one hand, we had very important dialogue pointing in the direction of national reconciliation, and as you know, this is one side of our work here in Iraq. And on the other hand, now we are discussing a topic of huge importance. The humanitarian side of our work, as you know, feeds into all the efforts underway. and all the efforts that were described by my distinguished co-panelists on answering this immense challenge. The humanitarian challenge created by the crisis in Iraq is overwhelming. We have to say that in comparison to other crises, other conflicts, civil wars, what happened in Iraq is staggering. And here I have to say I am hugely, hugely grateful, and I would like to recognize the efforts of the government of the region and also lately the central government, because we have honest and dedicated partners in them. What the Kurdish region has done in terms of accommodating internally displaced people and refugees is something that needs to be applauded on the international scale. And I have to say that the Kurdish region is standing up for the whole of Iraq. We have seen a lot of debates, arguments between Erbil and Baghdad in the last couple of months. I think what it boils down to is that this is a challenge they can only face together. And I have to say that there are many unsung heroes here. The United Nations is proud to work with people in government. I could mention a host of names. I don't want to, because the list would be unending. Here in the Kurdish region, we had some brilliant partners. I need to tell you, and of course I don't want to flatter anyone to their faces, that we have two wonderful, dynamic, young governors. I think any place in the world would take them to be their administrator. And they are taking this challenge very, very seriously, and we are very pleased to work together with them. Beyond that, I need to say that there was a very positive change in the attitude of the government since the new government has been formed. As Baghdad clearly understands the gravity of the situation, and I should also say a few words about those host communities that are acting to alleviate this horrible suffering. The host communities here in the Kurdish region have done a magnificent job, but also host communities in the central area and in the south in particular, they have done a great deal. We are extremely indebted to them. We believe that their work, their solidarity needs to continue, because sadly, as we used to say, we are still not out of the forest. This is an ongoing, difficult challenge. The figures are sadly more imposing than the ones that we normally see in the press. I'm not willing to bore you with too many statistics, but I need to mention here that with the ongoing difficult security situation creating more displacement, we already have 5.2 million people in need of humanitarian assistance across Iraq. This is a staggering number. Feeding, sheltering these people, providing them medical help, providing them infrastructure is a job that UN agencies alone cannot cope with. It needs to be a job supported by government, and I think the international community also needs to keep up its very important support for this immense humanitarian effort. Kurdistan is a special case. Can you imagine that in Kurdistan, one in six persons is an IDP? This is a ratio which I think is unprecedented. And Kurdish hospitality, of course, has been famous for the ages. We are now testing to the limits the ability of the region to cope with this influx. And here I say, a political solution to the crisis, together with a security solution, is indispensable, because we cannot expect Kurdistan to keep up with this kind of a performance. It is simply not feasible. At the same time, I need to tell you very frankly what both my co-panelists were referring to in terms of how much funding the UN agencies have for continuing their work. The picture is bleak. We have estimated that the full cost of keeping up our operations in the coming months would be $2.3 billion, a staggering sum. Sadly, only a fraction of this sum has as yet come on stream. And we believe that if there is no change in the attitude of the donor countries, we would really face a difficult situation. I am hopeful that the international community will not let Iraq down. And I am hopeful that there will be generous contributions from member states. Here, I need to mention that the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia last year helped us immensely with the $500 million assistance that was provided. Sadly, I need to admit, the United Nations needs to look at its practices of answering to the challenge of such humanitarian crisis again and again, because we cannot anymore rely on the largesse of individual member states only. It has to be an institutionalized effort. It is one of the big questions, how the world will be able to cope with this problem, especially in a situation where donor fatigue is setting in. The crisis in Iraq was classified as a level 3 humanitarian crisis by the United Nations. This is the highest classification of a crisis, which provides us the opportunity to do what we would not normally be doing in terms of funding and logistics and organization. However, I need to tell you that there are three other level 3 humanitarian crises simultaneously. This is totally unprecedented in the practice of the United Nations. Therefore, with due respect to all other crises, we believe that Iraq deserves to be taken into consideration as the most complex of all crises, one that begs for all the assistance and all the support the international community can give. Facing me is His Excellency Finance Minister Hoshyar Zebari. Minister, please make sure that the international community understands the gravity of the situation. I also turn to our friends, both politicians and media, and I think this will be repeated by my co-panelists. Let us leave no stone unturned to make the international community and the donors understand that unless there is fast, rapid reaction, and unless everybody does their share of the common job, we will be facing very serious humanitarian problems here. Evidently, I am also confident that work on the ground can be improved. The 19 UN agencies working on the ground are improving their cooperation, especially with regard to what was sorely missing previously, the civil-military cooperation element. Here we have a lot to do, and I think that with the ongoing process of rolling back ISIS, there will be a lot of communities we will be able to have access to. You are aware that access was a major problem in aid delivery. And we also believe that the IDP communities now stranded in camps or with communities would increasingly be in a position to go back. I do understand that many IDP communities are reluctant to do so because they had very bitter experiences with their neighborhood communities. I'm very loath to speak about this. This is very sad because it reminds me of the situation Europe faced in the Second World War and after the Second World War, where uprooted host communities, after the atrocities they suffered at the hands of their neighbors, were reluctant to return home. I am hopeful that in the end, the liberation of the areas currently under terrorist occupation will create the climate and the atmosphere suitable for everybody to go home, because ultimately this is the aim. I would be happy to see that this trickling back starts. We are not urging people to go back unless the conditions are suitable for them to go back to their communities. We believe that reestablishing security is a basic prerequisite for anybody to go home, but after that, I hope that the normalization can begin, and this would alleviate the immense burden on the Kurdish region and on other communities which are hosting the IDPs. So Let me finish this on a note of optimism. I think the international community, even if at the last moment, has always come on stream with assistance to countries in trouble. Iraq now is being perceived as the front country in the struggle against terrorism. There is a lot of political sympathy for Iraq in the world. And I believe that this sympathy will translate into active assistance. And I can assure you, the United Nations will continue doing its utmost to be the partner that we have always been in Iraq, the honest broker in politics and the dedicated helper in the humanitarian area. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Angus, as Georgie pointed out, this is a crisis of tremendous complexity. And one of the complexities is that aid agencies and donor countries, and yours is one of the biggest, are dealing with complications between Baghdad and Erbil. Can you talk about what it's like as a donor and the challenges there?
Certainly, thank you. And first of all, thank you to Dr. Barham and actually all the team in the American University for this event, for hosting us. Do not overestimate how much time as a diplomat or as a policymaker has time to think. So it's been great for 2 days to be in a room where my email isn't working properly and I can actually talk to real experts from a range of fields, policy, academia, journalism, and actually reflect on these issues. So Zuspes, thank you. As you said, it's a crisis of epic proportion, not just in Iraq, but also the Syria crisis. And in fact, my last job was, well, it started as a job in Damascus. Because of the situation there, it ended as a job in Beirut. And when I arrived in Beirut in spring 2012, I think the UN figures were, 70,000 or so Syrian refugees across the region. So looking back to a period that was less than 3 years ago, this displacement crisis has spiraled to the figures of over 3 million Syrian refugees. Over half the pre-crisis population of Syria is in need, alongside all the figures on Iraq. And we've heard from the governors of Duhok, of Sulaimani, of the burden placed on their governorates. But the sum burden, the collective burden of this crisis is one you have to add that of the mayor of Beirut or the mayor in the Bekaa Valley or governors in Jordan and in Turkey and in Syria, whether under the Syrian government or not. This is a crisis that is the sum of many local crises. So it's one of epic proportions. It's also a humanitarian crisis. It's a human crisis, but it's an inhuman crisis. In these conflicts, we have seen indiscriminate and orchestrated violence against civilians. Back in 2011, the acts of the Syrian government against its own people, the Dushka machine guns used in the squares of the Syrian cities, the bombardment, the barrel bombs, the use of chemical weapons, and even after the passing of Resolution 2118, the Syrian government using chlorine as a weapon. And thank goodness the Security Council has eventually agreed to make a ruling on that. And there are many armed groups in Iraq, in Syria, who are also predating on the civilian populations. Also, under international law, there are many offences carried out against other combatants. Combatants who might be prisoners or who have surrendered or are injured. And we see in the media, on our smartphones every day, the suggestion that these offences are happening too. And then the protection picture is compounded by the deliberate denial of humanitarian access, the barriers in front of humanitarian assistance, whether UN or NGOs. The siege tactics. And last week in the capital of Damascus, only a couple of miles from the city center, the UN agency UNRWA went into Yarmouk camp for the first time in 3 months. And at the moment, the Syrian government is pressing the UN to take out some of the key humanitarian officials from Syria, their persona non grata. So across Syria and in Iraq, the principle of humanitarian neutrality is being overlooked on many occasions. Now, we, the UK, in the Security Council, for example, are at the forefront of efforts to respond to that, to erode this culture of impunity. But of course, over the last few years, the members of the Security Council have not always seen eye to eye on this. There's actually the head of ICRC, the president of ICRC, Peter Maurer, last week, who said, "Wars without limits are wars without end." And of course, all of this and the response, it comes, as has already been said, with a heavy price tag. First and foremost, there has been no generosity greater than that of the neighbors of displaced people, of that of the host communities in Syria, in neighboring countries, in Iraq. But it's a very heavy price tag, and the UN 2015 appeal for Syria is $8.4 billion, the largest for a single crisis. I'm proud that up to now on Syria, the UK has been the second largest bilateral donor, £800 million, that's about $1.2 billion, and we're doing a significant amount in Iraq and on Iraq too. But as we've already heard, the latest appeal for Iraq is only 40% funded, the strategic response plan, and last year the UN appeal for Syria was only 57% funded. Even those commitments that are already there are going to dry up over this spring. So there is a compelling need for continued involvement by donors. It has to be reality, not just rhetoric. And there are some countries who so far have held back from contributing. So we hope, I think we all hope, that the Kuwait conference at the end of this month will be another step forward in donor commitment to these crises. But on the humanitarian crisis and what donors do, we need to improve the quality, not just the quantity. The UN, the government authorities, they want predictable long-term commitments. They want funds to be spread out quickly, and they want work on livelihoods, on the structures of coordination, and on the resilience of host communities. And my last point then will be on the role of governments in the region. And as we are here in Kurdistan region, in Iraq, I will confine my comments here to Iraq. And when it comes to this country, we welcome the hard work of the government authorities to date, the government in Baghdad, the KRG, the governorates. I'm no stranger to either of the two governors here because already I have met them several times with UK Department for International Development experts, humanitarian experts, talking through the practicalities of what they want or how we can improve the systems. And they have done a sterling job. I don't think any elected politician would want to take on a crisis in their first few days or weeks in office, but these two have done it in a stellar way. The government in Baghdad has responded through the coordination of the committee led by the Deputy Prime Minister, and most recently the creation of this joint coordination and monitoring mechanism, which we welcome and support. And here I have been impressed by the work of the KRG ministries, the governorates, and the host communities. It was actually on my last visit to Sulaimania that I saw Arbat camp and some of the scenes that the governor showed us. And it's very positive that the governor has committed land to new camps. I went by yesterday, work is still being done on it. And last week, I visited the KRG's new Joint Crisis Coordination Center in Erbil, which will improve the information flow between the ministries, between the center and the governorates, between the grand and everyone, between the local authorities and the donors and the UN. It's very welcome. But we need more of this. We want to see the Iraqi authorities in the driving seat for this Iraqi humanitarian crisis. We want to see Iraqi government and KRG budgets committed to this effort. And we want to see effective coordination, including coordination between the government in Baghdad and the authorities here. And there's some way to go. So I will stop there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Dr. Shaman, one of the most horrifying aspects of this crisis has been what's happened to women who have been taken captive, specifically Yazidi women. And while everyone is sympathetic and they want to help, no one seems quite sure the best way to do that. What do these women need? What do people need to do for the community?
Thank you very much. I'm going to start by briefly talking about the gender dimensions of the ISIS onslaught. I believe there are catastrophic gender dimensions to this crisis, not ignore. What I mean by that is the ISIS project treats men and women as friends or foes differently. And the differential treatment goes back to the essentialist view of ISIS as for men as naturally violent and aggressive in war and sex, and for women as just naturally submissive to men and providing comfort, be it sexual comfort or other. So I'll briefly talk about men and women who've joined ISIS and men and women as enemies of ISIS, and then I'll go on to talk about the plight of Yazidi women. Men in ISIS. First of all, these men, large numbers of men have been lured in by the promise of sex, money, and power, and at the end of it, of course, the promise of heaven, going to heaven. According to a CNN report that interviewed one of the prisoners, ISIS prisoners, the young man said that when they entered ISIS, they were each given a woman and $2,000, and of course, they were told that if they carry out jihad, they will go to heaven and have access to 72 women in heaven. Men are then trained to become a brutal and violent army, capable of breaching all of the laws of modern warfare, including taking civilians as hostage, torturing and murdering prisoners, rape, sexual slavery and trafficking, and most importantly, recently, destroying religious temples, museums, and archaeological sites. And all of these are considered war crimes. The women who join ISIS, a large number of women have been brainwashed that their jihad is to provide sex and sex and comfort to the warriors. There has been reports that women who refuse jihad and nikah have been killed in Mosul. There have been other reports about women throughout the Muslim world and even European countries being mobilized to join ISIS as providers of comfort and sex to men. Now I want to talk about men and women as enemies of ISIS, how they are treated. Men who do not convert to Islam, who resist ISIS ideology, or who are homosexual are considered infidels, kuffar, and they are deserving of beheading, burning alive, being thrown off tall buildings, and mutilation. So men, again, are victims that deserve being killed, you know, in various ways. But the women, on the other hand, as enemies of ISIS, are treated as spoils of war. They are raped, tortured, sold into sexual slavery, trafficked out of Iraq, and this is obviously the example of the Yazidi women that we've been witnessing. Various organizations have collected data about the number of Yazidi women and children who have been missing in the crisis. I believe the most reliable is the one collected by Nareen Sheikh Shamo, who's a Yazidi activist and is well connected to the community. According to the data she collected, there are 4,601 women and children who are missing from the Yazidi community. Obviously, images of Yazidi women being paraded in towns and cities and sold for $100 or less shocked all of us. Of course, trafficking women is not a new phenomenon. It's happened and it happens all over the world. But this is the first time it happens in our region on such a large scale, and it happens at the hands of a religious group, a radical religious group. Sexual abuse of women during warfare is a political strategy, of course. In this case, it satisfies the sexual desires of group members, the ISIS members. It makes money by selling these women to other agents, and also is an instrument of war and genocide. Amnesty International report in December 2014 speaks of 300 women at the time, hopefully there are more now, who have been able to escape ISIS. And these were women who had been bought off by Arab tribesmen and returned to the Kurds, or they fled during the during the airstrikes on ISIS. 42 of these women were interviewed by Amnesty International, and they all report similar experiences. They witnessed the murder on family members. They were tortured and physically abused. They were raped, forced into marriages, forced to convert into Islam. They became sex slaves, and many of them attempted suicide, and some of them succeeded. Rape, of course, in settings of armed conflict is used as physical torture, also demonstration of power and the humiliation of the victim group. The interesting thing is, again, ISIS does not only not deny these crimes, it actually takes pride in them because, again, it's a strategy of instilling fear, and it's a key to its success because making people fear that if they resist, this is what's going to happen to them. Through my research with Anfal surviving women, the genocide in Kurdistan, I found that women who were raped during the Anfal campaign were stigmatized, they were blamed for being raped, they were forced to relocate to a different region, deprived of custody of their children, and some of them were killed by relatives. Although rape of Yazidi women has become a part of the public discourse, survivors find it difficult to speak about their experiences. Generally, this is because women are held responsible for the crimes that are committed against them. Fortunately, soon after the first woman escaped ISIS, the spiritual Yazidi leader, Baba Sheikh, urged the Yazidi community to welcome these women back and support them and help them, and this was very helpful to prevent honor killing. But of course, this doesn't mean that the problem is over. The stigma remains, and many of the girls who were not married will find it very difficult to find husbands in the future. The shamefulness of this experience makes it very difficult for women to talk about it. Some of them are willing to talk about, yes, ISIS raped women, but it was never themselves or women they knew. It has always happened to some other people. And the difficulty of living in this contradiction where, on the one hand, they're being encouraged to talk about rape, to raise awareness about the crimes committed against the community, and to also raise awareness about the awful crimes of ISIS. On the other hand, when they talk, they are stigmatized and their life are going to be tainted by this. So women survivors suffer from flashbacks, nightmares, hyperarousal, fear, depression, and sleeplessness. I want to just quickly say a couple of things about what should be done. I believe there's a large number of women and children who are still in custody, in captivity. We don't know about their whereabouts, and the KRG should have a program to recover these women, find them and recover them. But this doesn't mean that the women immediately should be returned to their families. I think it's very important that the women themselves should be consulted. First of all, consulted on whether or not they want to be returning to their families or given new identities and move on to another place where they can live without stigma. Secondly, they should be consulted whether or not they want to talk about their experiences, and they shouldn't be pressurized into talking because this re-traumatizes them again. Another question is that of therapy. How effective is therapy for individual women when they still live with stigma and they still live in IDP camps, and we've been hearing about the situation, how bad that is? I personally believe that therapy alone would not be conducive if it's not in collaboration with other projects and, you know, community projects to address justice, stigmatization, and opportunities. I want to end with one positive note, and that is every crisis, most crises have also an opportunity in them. And I want to end by mentioning the role of women fighters in Kobani in defeating ISIS. Here we witness the defeat of patriarchal radical religious group which consisted mainly of male fighters at the hands of a group that consisted of 35% women, and it was co-leadership, so there was a woman leader to the movement as well. This small group was under siege for 133 days. It lost 433 members, and it managed to succeed. Of course, it managed to succeed with the airstrikes with US aid. But still, these women in this battle exhibited very many abilities that are considered masculine, such as perseverance, bravery, patriotism, leadership, and good strategies. And I think we should celebrate them, and I hope that's going to be a point for us to reconsider our traditional perceptions of gender and gender inequality.
Thank you so much. Deb, I wonder if we could get your thoughts on how does one, journalists, how do we break through that listener-viewer fatigue where people are just overwhelmed with these terrible, tragic stories? And I'd also like to get your thoughts, too, on this isn't just an immediate crisis. It has huge implications for the future of Syria, for Iraq. You could address that.
I think humanitarian reporting is one of the hardest things to do. one refugee is a tragedy, any more are a statistic. And our listeners and our readers and our viewers understand that. So the battle in covering these crises is to find individual stories to highlight the larger plight. And that takes resources, work, and time. I find that there is not only donor fatigue, but there is editor fatigue. Tell me something new. I already know that. There's nothing new in the refugee story. It is very difficult. We are faced with the same challenges that aid agencies are faced with, and their challenge is to find a new adjective to get people to pay attention to what's happening. And what we see today is a variety of aid agencies have released a report today which calls on the UN and charges it with failure. Failure to address the refugee crisis, certainly in Syria, failure to address this huge, unprecedented number of IDPs and refugees. In my mind, I think there's enough failure and charges of failure to go around. And I want to pick up on something that Angus talked about. And that is, in some ways, there's a failure in the system. In Syria, we watched a shocking example of thousands of people starving in a camp in the middle of an urban center where food could be bought cheaply enough within a mile of where these people were. We saw the same thing in eastern Ghouta. We have reports that the Syrian government removed all medical aid from aid trucks that were moving into opposition areas. The starvation in Yarmouk camp was not a humanitarian problem. It was a political problem. And it's a problem of how humanitarian aid works. The UN system bases its entire operation on sovereignty. And so a sovereign government is in control of the aid that comes into its country. And in this case, both food and medicine were used in Syria as a weapon of war. It was reported somewhat, but hardly challenged publicly, that this system is simply unsustainable. You cannot withhold aid and medicine from civilians simply because they happen to live in opposition areas. And yet, that is exactly what happened until the UN passed a resolution in February to allow cross-border aid. It's not been very effective, and that is part of the charge of failure by these aid agencies. And I think going forward, we have to look at the systemic failures as well as the failures of donor fatigue, journalism fatigue, because these are far more important for ongoing crises. It also happened in the polio epidemic in Syria. WHO, also a member of the UN system, was duty-bound to use the samples that came through the Damascus government, coming out of opposition areas of reports of polio. The first reports from Damascus were this was Guillain-Barre disease, and it came from the illegal refining of petroleum products. There were samples that were smuggled out to Turkey by the opposition, and the Turkish government said, no, this is polio. And so the WHO was forced to acknowledge that this was polio. If you look at the polio in particular, what you begin to see is there are organizations and governments breaking the rules. And in the next stage of the campaign to bring vaccines to people in opposition areas, there was a huge breaking of the rules that even included ISIS. ISIS has children, and they wanted those vaccines into northern Syria, and it was done with the collaboration of the Turkish government, WHO, opposition groups, and yes, even ISIS. We've also seen on the Turkish border that there have been covert aid programs that have been run by the American government, the British government, European governments, to break this siege of aid inside Syria. Not terribly effective because it has been difficult. And so I think that we have to be very clear-eyed about what's happened in Syria. And I have to say, I can't let the Iraqi government off the hook either. I was here in November. I was in Duhok, and I was in a very large camp for IDPs, internally placed, citizens of Iraq. These were Yazidis. And they said no Iraqi official from Baghdad had been to see them. And if you talk to people from Mosul, they'll tell you the same thing. No official from Baghdad, from the central government, had been to see them. Kurdish officials, terrific. They have taken the burden. But IDPs are the responsibility of the central government. And so it's a message to these people that you don't count. And they felt that, and they complained about it. You know, in the beginning of this crisis in Syria and then in Iraq, we all talked about the end of Sykes-Picot, the end of borders. And in my mind, that's really not what's happened. It's not the borders have moved, it's the people who have moved. And it may be that some of this will be permanent. There are studies about refugees that say 30% don't go home. The Turkish government is already talking that maybe 50% won't go home. And I think we also have to address the humanitarian effort going forward to the idea that we are now looking at a very, very long-term problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we have about 20 minutes for a lot of questions. I know Governor Asso wants to say a few words, but we'll take a few questions first. And first question, Dr. Sarbaugh, please. Microphone right behind you.
Hello, thank you. Does it work? Thank you so much. I think this is a very, very important panel. It is affecting all of us. It is going to be a lot of questions, but my question is, first of all, my name is Sarba Sali, and I have an organization called Kurdistan Botanical Foundation. We study the plants, so I'm in agriculture. So my question is going to be in agriculture and how we can do something with the refugees, with the IDPs. I have visited many camps in Arbat, in Barika, and also in Baharka, and spoken to many of the refugees, and I have noticed that they need help in every way, but one of them we need to talk about, I think it would be a good idea, is to have a pilot project for them to start with the governor of Sulaimania and maybe Duhok, and our representative deputy of UN is here, and also our agriculture minister is here. Maybe we can establish something for these people to be involved in doing some agriculture programs. It would be helping them psychologically, and also many of them, they are in the countryside, and I think it could be done, but it needs a lot of work. So that was my question, and I hope we can talk more about it.
Wonderful, thank you so much.
Yeah, hello to everybody. Thanks for such a good panel. I have some question. Before I'm giving my question, I need to explain something. There is two research. One has been done in France and the other has been done in German. The first was been done by Ralph Radban, which is a German and Lebanese. There is between, they did in France, and they, this research explained that 45% from this pool, they want to join Daesh were being women. So it's a huge number. And between 378% from German, which they are joined Daesh, were being 12% were women. If Daesh doing such violence and abusing women, why women are joining Daesh? There's a question. And there's something else which has been done also in Duhok. We have an organization which is called the Leadership Peace for the leadership. It's also between 531 women which they were returned to Dohuk from under Daesh's control. Only 28 women are going through rehabilitation. The other are out of rehabilitation. And I made someone, really they cannot explain because of their emotionally situation, they cannot explain anything. It means that all of them need to go through the rehabilitation center. Thank you very much, and I want only the questions is explain why all those women are joining Daesh. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. The gentleman right there.
First of all, I want to thank Dr. Barham for giving us this opportunity, which has been wonderful to listen to such experts. I'm from Jordan, and we share the same concerns with Iraq and with the Kurdistan region in particular of hosting refugees. I'm the chairman of a company called IrisGuard, and as part of our contribution to this humanitarian crisis, we have developed iris recognition technology that's now being used by UNHCR to register refugees, and more importantly, to pay them assistance through ATM machines that are equipped with those devices where those refugees don't need to have bank accounts or cards or to use PINs. The message is that UNHCR has eliminated 100% of the fraud that happens sometimes with those cases, as they have experienced in Pakistan with Afghani refugees. And this also helps in family reunification when refugees are dispersed. By using their biometrics, you can help overcome their challenges and bring them together. But I salute everyone here who's involved in supporting refugees, and thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you so much. There was a question here in the front row, and then we'll go over there.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Arif. Just a comment to Ms. Amos. Frankly, it was a very real practice. This is what we have experienced during our relationship and coordination with the United Nations agencies, as well as with UNAMI and donor countries, especially when it comes to centralization of that effort. Unfortunately, KRG so far for the last 3-4 years has not been a key partner in terms of the donation discussions with Iraq when it comes to headquarter discussions or head office discussions back in New York, Geneva. And I believe it's very much essential to make KRG involved in terms of prioritization and figures and data to be released. Back also with centralization, again we have the same problem when it comes to the practical side of it, of course, because UN agencies in terms of donations received to Iraq, KRG must be fully in collaboration with that. And that has to be, again, UN must be of, I believe, must be of support to KRG in terms of allocations of most of the donations. Because for the first 2 years, 2011 and 12, most of the donor countries from Gulf countries that have been allocated funds from their countries, unfortunately, were given somehow in conditions in certain countries, in Lebanon, in Jordan. But unfortunately, Iraqi foreign policy, I have to say, lacking that sort of highlight and, of course, focus to make of Iraq as a priority and second of KRG again as a priority for the donation. Thank you.
Thank you. We had a question from Ali, and then we're going to go to the back to get some students. Ali? I'm sorry, front row first. One last one here. Thanks.
Good afternoon. I'm Ali Kaderia, former American official. For the governors, I wonder what measures you're taking to ensure counter-radicalization that usually occurs in these refugee camps, given the general lack of hope and economic opportunity. Refugee camps usually become incubators for jihadis or other extremist groups. What is the Iraqi government or the Kurdistan region doing to confront that threat?
They are Yazidis, so they don't.
That was
Syrian and
Iraqi
refugees and displaced persons. Thanks.
Thank you. That was a question as opposed to the valuable comments we've had, so perhaps we could get an answer to that. Do you feel like answering? Both of you would be lovely.
First of all, I would like to thank the people of Duhok and to thank the civil servants working a brilliant job. If not because of the people of Duhok, we could not do all this job. The second one, I would like to mention that the contribution of the federal government it was very limited, unfortunately, to say that. And it's very unfortunate that all officials left, so we could tell them exactly what is the situation in Duhok. We have almost one-third of all IDPs in KRG in Duhok, or maybe even in Iraq. So what has been presented or contributed by the federal government was very limited. So the issue of liberated areas is another problem for us. Now there are many sub-districts liberated by our Peshmerga forces, thank to them, but they need a lot of help. They need basic needs. They have problem with water, drinking water. They have problem with electricity. So this is another issue should be addressed by UN, and I think they are very keen to know about that one. For the issue of women, Yazidi women, which mentioned by Nermin Khan, yes, they are not saying that because of social and sometimes religious reasons. I mean, this woman, they want to cover it. They are shy to tell their families, their relatives that this has been done to them. And some of them, they are very child that they don't know what happened to them. I didn't want to say here publicly, but we had a small committee 6 months ago to deal with these cases. We have very sensitive cases we could not reveal to the media. 13, 12 years old girl was raped and she doesn't know what happened to her. And she doesn't allow the doctor even to look at her because she says, nothing happened to me because nobody touched. And the doctor is telling us, no, she was raped. So this is a real tragedy, as I said, but because of social and sometimes because of personal reasons, these women are not ready to tell the public or to help for, to ask for the help.
And is there indeed, as Ali was asking, a problem with potential extremism
Jane, before I answer that one, we have a very critical problem in maybe in Sulaimania also. I will not speak on behalf of KRG, but KRG having more than 1.8 million refugees. In Duhok, I have almost 7 out of 10 people visiting the hospitals are IDPs. I mean, people of Duhok are becoming minority. And I would say that in front of Dr. Barham, he was the prime minister. Duhok was left behind. Sulaimania was very good in terms of infrastructure. Erbil is much better. Duhok was left behind because of many reasons. So there is a lot of pressure on the infrastructure, and we hope that the UN agencies, diplomatic missions will understand that if the situation collapses in Duhok, the host community will not be able anymore to have these people. And Vice President Nujafi was telling me, you have to prepare yourself for more than 750,000 more IDPs if there is any attack on Mosul in the near future. So I hope that the international community will also move on that one. On Ali's question, yes, we don't have much problem in IDPs camps because most of them are Yazidis and some few of them are Christians. But we have small problems in refugee camps, but they are not jihadists. We have security problems. We have small groups of gangs, maybe sometimes. And because of unemployment and many other problems, those people maybe sometimes will become criminal and making problems. By the way, Jane, we have a full structure dealing with refugees and IDPs, 400 staff, and the assistant of the governor is managing 20 camps. The management of the camps, it's a huge burden on us. if each family in each day have one bag of garbage in one camp, then you will have 5,000 bags of garbage. Somebody has to collect them, somebody has to transport them, somebody has to deal with them. Nobody understands that. The Iraqi government only sends some money to build some camps. Yeah, but that is not enough. We are afraid of cholera. He's a doctor, he will tell you. We have that problem every year in Duhok, that we have a committee we activated to prevent cholera to spread in Duhok. If nobody help us, if the Iraqi government doesn't take the lead, as he said, we are not able to have almost, as I said, 700,000 people to feed them, to provide health services, to provide education, and to help them in different ways. So now we are preparing ourselves, and we are afraid of cholera. Scabies is what is?
Scabies.
Scabies. Now we have cases in our camps, and nobody is talking about that. We could not say to the media, but we are afraid that if this spread, it will spread to the whole province and maybe the whole region. These are very serious issues. WHO, they are very helpful, but still, as I said, we cannot do it alone. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're just going to take a couple of questions from students, and we're going to be done in 10 minutes, I swear. At the back, are you students? Yes. The man in the black shirt?
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to IOIS. I would like to thank all of the men and women who are here, because they mentioned Yazidis and Yazidis issue. I would like just to have one question. Actually, before that, I would like to thank Ms. Hardy, because she mentioned a good thing about the Yazidi religious men who welcome back their girls, because some people, they try to make stereotype, and they say that Yazidis will not welcome their girls back. Actually, it's wrong, and we, like, really proud of our girls. But the question here is that many families try to buy back their girls, so and they pay a lot for it. So why don't the Iraqi government or Kurdistan government pay money to them so they can buy back their girls? So this is my question. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Governor Asso is pointing out that I promised him he could have 3 more minutes.
Will be less than that. Okay.
Please.
Thanks. Just to say, I would like to thank Kaka Farhat. So first of coming here, and secondly, for being of help, because he started about 8 months before me, and he had all this experience of dealing with refugees and IDPs, and he was really of help, always on the line if I had any problems. So just thank again. I think just Iraq is still not a priority in for the international community, and that needs to be raised and highlighted very clearly. Iraq is now, the whole Iraq, and especially the KRG, is really facing a huge problem with refugees and IDPs, and that needs to be the priority of the international community. I hope that Mr. Jaffery was here, and that reminded me just to comment on some of what he said. But the foreign minister of Iraq needs to take into consideration that the governor in Iraq, in the KRG and the rest of Iraq, are more knowing, or they know better, what are the problems with refugee and IDP, and I think they need to be involved in the effort of Iraq to try to highlight how the issue is big for the to the international community. من بس دشتك بكردي ألم براستي تعقيبك لسروي جنابي جعفري كزوس باسي أكم برادران أو شراء يعني من تعقيبك من سرو شراكي أستهم ما أنتوش ما أبوا أم شرشتي كسيرة يعني دجمن للايك وقينو رقي خوي هي هولاكو كان هي بعسيا كان هي حجاجيا كاني كوغرتو تو دجب برامبر بملتي كرد شتي وروينه او لا برامبر بواش امل سنگري كاين همو اني كليرا دانشتوين سنگري چين پارزراني ديموكراسين پارزراني ازادين پارزراني ايني راستقيرين پارزراني مافي مروفين مافي جنانين للمجوا شتيوانه بورنگ بخوب ما بينيايا پیش مرگو پککو یا پیش بیکو لیک سنگری خواهد شرب کن. یکم جار روبا ایران لسر زمین شرب که بلاتی گرتوکانی امریکا لسر و قصف که. یکم جار روبا ترکیه ریبا و پیش مرگو چه تنان کوبانی لکوبانی سنگر بگریه لگل جنانه.
یکم جار روبا پیشمرگا لایکی لشی شهید کردو خوب چه شهید کا یکم جار روبا سرکدی کی وک کاک حما به 70 سالی چه کرکی خو لگل کرکی خو یاو لوی شهید به یکم جار روبا سرکد پیشمرگا شهید به براستی شری کی گوریا و میجوی کردی نوسیته و دس خوشی له هر همتان دکم
Okay. What I would really like to do is allow the student there who has been waving her hand to ask a very quick question. I'm sorry, the young woman there.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. I just want to ask Dr. Asso, you had a great presentation. Thank you. It was very informative. But I have a question. You have mentioned the future plans, and the future plans only had creating and establishing 6 camps.
True.
But you said you are struggling with education and health. So do you think building camps is much important than solving the problems that the refugees are recently having? Because I have been visiting these camps, and most of the women, they are crying because of the health issues their children are having.
True.
And I think the government needs to work more on that rather than only building camps. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you so much.
Very brief. The thing with the camps are you can resettle those who are scattered everywhere. Having scattered people, you will struggle having helping people from the health point of view, from the education point of view, from the humanitarian point of view. Having them in camps make the issue or the matter easier for the government to reach, to have a better reach, to outreach to them. So that's why I totally agree with you. It's easier health issue than health and education. It will be easier to be provided inside these camps. That's why we give a priority to have camps. And I still think we need more than 5 to 6 camps to accommodate all these refugees. Having said that, we have about 25 to 30 families, continuous influx of people daily, as I talk now. Thanks.
Thank you so much. I'm really sorry we didn't get to those questions. Really so sorry. But I think the panelists will be around if anyone wants to ask them. So thank you very much to the panelists. Thank you, Dr. Barham, for the wonderful forum. Thank you to the students and the volunteers.
Sorry,
Mr. President,
we didn't have answers.
Yeah, some of those we didn't. It's true.
Thank you.